Knowledge is power, and that's never been more accurate than in fighting games, to the point that it can feel like a gatekeeper. Knowledge checking is the practice of repeatedly using a technique that your opponent visibly doesn't know how to deal with, but which can definitely be countered. And let's be honest, it sucks to be knowledge checked, no matter your level of experience. But no, the opponent isn't being cheesy. If you're playing to win, this is a fight to the metaphorical death, not a cautious duel. So if a technique works, keep using it until you win or your opponent has figured out how to stop it from working. With that being said, while it is entirely within the other player's power to remedy the lack of knowledge, it is often the game's fault for not providing it. Sure, you can Google things or ask on Discord, but community-based support for something you paid for kind of sucks, you know? Unfortunately, it seems that game developers have taken their cue from the Blood Ravens rather than Thomas Hobbes, because if knowledge is power, they are guarding it well. With a few exceptions, fighting games have a history of being terrible at teaching you how to play them. And this struggle to communicate information to the players, especially the new ones, is a big way fighting games shoot themselves in the foot in terms of bringing new people in. I'm just guessing here, but this might be due to the arcade roots of the genre, where any time spent teaching you the game is time spent not playing, which is time spent not losing credits, i.e. time not spent making money for the cabinet's owner. You can even argue that the deliberate vagueness, if not downright secrecy about the mechanics, could be used as a way to keep players putting coins in the cabinet as they discover some new tech just before they get bodied. That possible holdover from the past could be why, even if the game even bothers to include a tutorial, it will usually do little more than tell you what the buttons do and what are the system mechanics that are specific to this game. Beyond that, you're left to your own devices, and it's up to you to figure out a move's purpose. This might be obvious for fighting games veterans, but yes, moves have purposes besides dishing out damage to your opponent. There's a reason why, in this specific situation, with this specific character, it's better to press medium kick than light kick. In the FGC, you might hear a character's moveset referred to as their toolkit, because the moves are tools and, as such, they are intended to be used for specific tasks in specific situations, although it doesn't necessarily mean that that's the only task they're good for. It is my belief that understanding this concept is one of the first steps away from button mashing. Yet, few are the games who will actually tell you things like, this move is an overhead, this one is good as an anti-air, this one can destroy projectiles, or this move is invincible for part of the animation. These days, with home and online gaming being the norm, I can't really think of a reason not to make that information more easily accessible. It's getting better though, and command lists are becoming more and more usable. Some games will go as far as displaying an attack's frame data, but nuggets of information such as when the move is good to use or the difference between the different strength versions of a move are arguably more useful to a greater number of people. Granblue Fantasy Versus and Guilty Gear Strive are excellent examples of what good command lists look like, with the latter getting bonus points for also listing universal moves, and we can see that other developers are following the lead. Soul Calibur 6 and Them's Fighting Herds also get a special mention for getting some of that information across in a very succinct way. Killer Instinct has the good idea of showing a customizable list of key moves that show up as soon as you pause the game, and NRS games go one step further and let you pin the inputs of one or more moves to the screen so that you can refer to them while playing, which is great quality of life improvement when trying out a new character. Dead or Alive 5 went even further than that and had a feature where, in training mode, you could have the possible moves displayed on screen as you press buttons. This is especially useful to learn moves in 3D games and their long sequences of inputs. So, why did you get rid of it in DOA 6, Tecmo? Anyway, some games have character guides that expand a bit more on what makes that character unique, but even those don't tell you anything about the character's normal attack, aka their normals. DNF Duel being the only exception I'm aware of. Likewise, very few games will give you an overview of the character on the selection screen, such as the intended playstyle and overall complexity. While it's not necessarily that hard to figure out, it cannot hurt to have that information readily available, so it would be nice to see more of this in future games. As important it might be to know what knowledge to share, if it's communicated poorly, the transfer won't be very effective. We talked about command lists, which are an important reference sheet, but those alone won't teach you the game properly. Many fighting games seem to think that throwing a bunch of text at you and maybe letting you press buttons once is enough to call you proficient.
Combat training.
Ah!
Seven fighting games.
In education circles, a very common illustration is that of the pyramid of learning, which is meant to illustrate how much knowledge you retain based on how it was given to you. As it turns out, there is no scientific basis for these specific numbers, but the idea that learning from a combination of reading, listening, watching, and doing being more effective than doing any one of these things on its own still stands, and I think should be intuitive, especially for something that is a physical skill. Reading is already covered, and listening could be relatively easily solved by spending more development budget on adding voiceovers in the tutorial.
When you flash white, you're invulnerable to strikes.
So I want to focus on the watching and doing part. For all the flack Tekken 7 gets for its lack of tutorial, you have to give it credit for having decent tools to learn moves, such as a real-time demonstration with additional audio cue for the correct timing. Arxis games also have demonstrations with the list of inputs, but I've personally found them a bit less useful because the layout is such that you have to choose between looking at the characters or looking at the timing. But as we said, there's a limit to how much watching a move being performed can help you perform it yourself. So at some point, you need to start doing. Again, during tutorials, it's usually minimum service, where you'll get moved on to the next stage after doing the thing once. Some games will ask you to do the thing a number of times, but in such a controlled environment that you might not recognize the situation when it arises in a real match. For instance, asking me to block 5 low moves in a row isn't going to prepare me to face an opponent mixing me up. In some cases, they also expect you to complete the task in a very specific way that can be overly restrictive, making the skill appear more difficult than it really is. TFH does something very clever in that it changes the tutorial sections in a natural manner. Hey, you've just learned how to block. Now do it again. Sight, this was a low attack. I think this is a pretty good way of showing the player when a certain move is not the right solution to a problem, because now they have experienced what the failure mode looks like in a situation where they, hopefully, won't feel dumb for falling for it. Some games will have one or more tests that look a bit more like a real fight, but it's still missing one thing, the ability to practice these freely for as long as you like. Some tutorials will let you keep practicing the current technique until you decide to move on, but in most cases, if you want to keep doing reps while keeping your pride intact, you'll have to go into training mode, or the lab as it's sometimes called. Once again, Tekken 7 unexpectedly shines here, with the ability to display the moves inputs on screen while you're practicing it, and easily browse from move to move, and show the demonstration at any time. But more importantly, it has a mode called Punishment Training, where you can learn how your character can deal with another character's moves, aka punishing those moves, and then practice by having the attacks of your choice thrown at you randomly. I think the devs didn't go far enough with this idea, but it's great that it's there, because matchup knowledge is another very important chunk of information that fighting games tend to be shy about handing out. Some Arxis games have some how to deal with that one move from that character challenges, but the setup is so artificial that it's not very likely to translate to an under-pressure situation. And more importantly, they don't tailor the advice to your specific character. TFH and DNF Duel will actually customize some of the basic tutorial sections depending on which character you picked. But being part of the tutorial, they tend to suffer from the same issues of lack of opportunity to practice in realistic conditions. While training modes have become more and more powerful, allowing you to recreate nearly any combat scenario, I wouldn't blame a beginner if they found the idea of having to learn a learning tool an off-putting one. That's why having pre-made setups could be useful for people to practice the fundamentals, something that Street Fighter VI is trying to do, which is great to see. And to be clear, I'm absolutely not saying you have to spend hours on end in training mode. It's very few need it, and if that's how you learn best, go for it. But the fact that, within the community, people who live inside training mode are called lab monsters should clue you into the idea that this isn't exactly the norm. Many people would rather learn on the go. For the 225 hours of online play I have in Strive, I've spent only 5 in training mode. That's around 2%. And that is the first fighting game I took seriously. That's not necessarily the most efficient way of practicing, but at least I'm playing rather than doing what might feel like homework. However, as poet Sarah Kay said, practice does not make perfect. Practice makes permanent. Repeat the same mistakes over and over and you don't get any closer to Carnegie Hall. So while having a space to practice is important, the most important tool for learning is feedback, which is the second type of information fighting games could be better at communicating. As previously said, many fighting game tutorials, after explaining you something, will only ask you to do it a few times at best, and they will silently judge you until you get it right. Mortal Kombat 11 tries to be a bit more helpful by displaying the timing windows for basic combos, and if you mess something up, it will actually tell you what, at least to the best of its ability. Unfortunately, it only does that in the tutorial and not in training modes, although it looks like Street Fighter V might be displaying cancel windows. Watching replays is also an important learning tool that is often underused by many FGC members, myself included, but some games are trying to make the most of them. Street Fighter VI will show the frame advantage of each interaction during replays, which is useful for you to realize that you probably shouldn't have pressed a button there. You also have Tekken 7, which also tries to give you some feedback in replays and suggests possible punishments, although I think they aren't taking that latter idea far enough again. And then we have Replay Takeover in Guilty Gear Plus R, which lets you answer questions like, what if I had done that instead, without having to know how to perform your opponent's combo so you can set it up in training mode. Fury Fighter recently released a video on that topic, which I'll encourage you to watch. As he says, this should really exist in every game. But training mode and watching replays are still very dry experiences you have to want to get into, so it'd be nice to see other, more engaging ways to teach core mechanics. And just in case I need to spell it out, making the game easy and making the game easy to learn are not the same thing. Nobody cares that back in the day we had to learn by going to the school of 0 and 2 uphill both ways, guessing what the moves even were, and there's no reason that people nowadays should go through the same. The quicker and more effectively we can get people to learn, the more people you'll have to play with. Extra Credits suggested 8 years ago that a well-crafted single experience mode would help a lot with that, and I agree. But after all this time, TFH is, to my knowledge, the only game that got anywhere close to that ideal, with its story mode and inclusion of NPCs and boss fights designed to teach you, for instance, how to anti-air a jumping opponent or how to deal with projectile spam. So I hope we'll see more of this in the future as well. Granblue Fantasy Versus had a golden opportunity with the RPG mode, but they squandered it by being closer to a beat-em-up than a fighting game. However, a fully featured single-player story mode is not something every developer is going to be able to afford doing. So it would still be helpful to have tools that help with learning while playing in versus, arcade or online modes. In the comments of the last video, something that often came up as a reason why the learning curve feels so steep is that it can be hard to figure out what's going on in the middle of a match. Understanding by just watching the animations when you're starting out can be difficult, especially when they're drowned in particle effects, but even then, they wouldn't necessarily tell you the whole story. Some games have decided that they shouldn't tell you anything, and other games will try to give you information about what just happened. For instance, knowing that you got counter-hit is important since it tells you that you lost this interaction because your attack was slower, mistimed, and/or shorter range than your opponent's. Some games will be subtle about it, and others, not so much. Likewise, being told that you got punished teaches you that your attack missed or wasn't safe. These are the most common notifications, but some games have experimented with giving more info. GBVS lets you know if you got hit by a low or an overhead attack while using the wrong kind of block. It also explicitly tells you the moment when a move is invincible. BlazBlue Cross Tag Battle and TFH make it a bit more obvious that your opponent is trying to throw you, and whether that throw can be broken or not. To my knowledge, DNF Duel is the only game that properly explained what those notifications mean and the value of paying attention to them. Things like these are good for both beginners to the genre and to the game in question, so that every interaction in the match is potentially a teachable moment, allowing people to learn while playing. It's obviously not going to be sufficient due to the pace of most matches, leaving you little time to analyze what just happened, but as a certain grocery store brand says, every little helps. I've heard some concerns that there might be a point where information like this might change the way the game is played, so I'm opening the floor to you all. Fighting game veterans, what sort of information and feedback game developers could add to help beginners understand the game as they're playing it? And where is the line that shouldn't be crossed? Fighting games beginners, what kind of on-screen information do you think would be the most useful in helping you learn? Please let us know in the comments, and as usual, be nice to each other. And I'll see you next time. Hello, I wanted to say thank you for all the positive comments on my first video on this channel. I didn't expect it to have that many views and generate that many subscriptions. It's been very encouraging, and to be honest, I welcome the positivity because it's been a bit of a shit year for me. And yes, I will make more videos, but I can't promise any regularity at the moment. It's gonna be a done when it's done kind of affair. I do have one more video I want to make before I start on that tutorial series I promised. So, yeah, you know what to do to get notified about it. and I may not respond to everyone, but I do read all the comments, at least the ones I get notified about. So please keep them coming. And thanks again for your support. And see you soon.